to go to Beijing and take part in two conferences organised by the International Department of the Central Committee. And these conferences were preparatory conferences for the third plenary meeting of the 11th Central Committee. They have wonderful titles in communist countries, aren't they? Third plenary meeting of the 11th Central Committee, Communist Party of China. By the time you've done that, you finish the meeting, you don't have to send it. But we were helping to prepare this conference and two workshops, one in which we spoke about diplomacy and one in which I was asked to speak about how the world was changing and what China's position in the world would look like. And I've since been asked to write a paper which I sent to the Communist Party, which apparently has been circulated, about what China's position in the world is. So the idea is I'm going to share some of these thoughts with you tonight. You can see just how desperate the Chinese Communist Party are if they invited me to write this down. There is one thing with your patience. If we finish with time, I'd also like to take advantage of showing you part of a film that's been made by grade 11 economics students, which I think you would enjoy. I'd just like you to see what our 16-year-olds get up to. They scare me. I hope they'll impress you. But we'll start with China and the world. If you want to talk about the China in the world, the first thing we've got to understand is what's the world like? Because China is trying to engage with a world that's changing very fast. And I don't think we are always aware of how fast or how dangerously the world is changing. The changes happen, and we don't notice. So where are we in the world? Well, we think we're in a world called globalisation. The trouble is that nobody knows what globalisation means. It's one of these words we use to avoid thinking. Oh, it's globalisation. We can park it, it's fine. I once hosted a seminar at London School of Economics. I spent a year there as a visiting fellow in the Global Studies Centre, and I hosted a workshop or seminar. I was with very senior people coming along, a bit scary. I mean, Tony Giddens, these were the gurus of globalisation at the time. I was trying to think, what angle would I take? Well, my angle was to say, you're not allowed to say globalisation. Every time you want to talk about globalisation, you've got to explain what you mean. And I destroyed the seminar. Because all these famous professors, Tony Giddens, the guru of the third wave, stop talking about globalisation. No, stop, Tony, stop. What does it mean? I mean, what it means it means everything's gone global, Shaun. Right, try again. It had really become one of these phrases, a bit like the BRICS, which we spoke about briefly last week, which we'll come back to a bit later. You know, we talk about the BRICS, it avoids us thinking about whether the BRICS have anything in common. My contention is the BRICS have nothing in common with each other, or nothing relevant. But we get the term BRICS, no need to think, we'll talk about the BRICS. Let's be really careful with these terms. So try to think about what globalisation really means. I mean this, and it doesn't mean any more than this. It means that we're in an increasingly interdependent world in which things shift around. And things shift around with increasing speed, with increasing freedom. And what are the things that shift around? Well, goods, services, people, money, ideas, information. That's great, like they're moving around. And then crime. And disease. Violence. Who are way ahead of the curve on globalisation? Who were the real innovators? The mafia. They're so far ahead of the rest of us. They got globalisation, but we were still thinking of national police forces. They were well ahead, moving stuff around the world, moving money around the world, moving arms around the world, moving drugs around the world, moving people around the world. They're so much better at it than we are. A friend of mine once suggested, after 9/11, if you want to stop counter-terrorism, if you want to stop international terrorism, legalise all drugs. Because the terrorists will lose all the networks they use to move money and people around the world. And of course, disease. One of the things we forget is how vulnerable we have become. I forgot that for a moment's time. It probably will be mine next. We forget how vulnerable we've become to disease in this world. In the old days, you went to Africa and you got some terrible tropical disease. It took 6 weeks to get back to Britain. And by the time you got off the ship in Britain, all the symptoms had come out and you were quarantined and nothing happened. These days, you go to Africa, get some terrible disease, get on a plane, fly back, 6 hours later, get off the plane, no symptoms yet. Symptoms emerge 2 days later. Go to your doctor. He's got no idea. Why should he? Gives you a paracetamol. Sends you away. You get seriously ill, you die. You go to hospital. In hospital, they finally do an autopsy on you, cut you open, find that actually you've got something really virulent, nasty disease. By that time, you've infected all your friends and neighbours. The only reason it's not happened so far is we've been lucky. The closest we got was an American went to Africa, Central Africa, got Nile's disease. Nile disease is invariably fatal, highly infectious, serious disease. Went back to New York, died 5 days later. Only after death had the autopsy, they realised with horror, this guy had been walking around New York with Nile's disease, nobody else caught it. And they've got no idea what to do. We were lucky, one day we won't be lucky. If you ever want to think about his disease a security issue, Spanish influenza 1918 killed more people in 6 months than the generals of the First World War had killed in 4 years. And they tried. Boy, they tried to kill people, they were professionals. And he's walking that machine gun slowly. Spanish influenza killed more people in 6 months. It's something like 50 million worldwide. We still don't know where it came from, and we still don't know why it went away. Sorry, never mind that. Disease and globalisation. Okay, what do you need for globalisation? The things we don't ask. If you're going to have globalisation, we think that globalisation is a natural process. No, it's not. You need things for globalisation to happen. So you need transportation. You need technology. You need communications. Otherwise, these things aren't going to flow around the world. You also need cheap energy. Maybe a problem. But the ones we forget about is if you want things to flow around the world, you need an international rule set, a single international rule set that everybody adheres to. And why does everyone adhere to it? Because you've got a global enforcer. There's an international hegemon. I'm sorry, the dirty secret of international relations, international law does not exist, nor do international institutions. Rule sets only work if there's somebody willing to enforce the rule set. In true throughout history, it's not changed just because we think we're civilised in the 21st century. We only think that in Europe, are we? Okay, globalisation 1, pre-1914. We forget we've been there before. If you ever anyone's ever read Domaine Arcane's Economic Consequences of the Peace, fantastic book. Lovely, nasty jokes about Woodrow Wilson and Lloyd George. Economics is rubbish, but the humour's great. He starts off with a wonderful description of someone said, it is, you got it wrong. You got all the data on German reparations wrong. He talks about somebody sitting down to have breakfast in London before the First World War, 1912, and how they're able to order everything from around the world. And you'll get there. So we have the technology. We have transportation by ship and rail. Technology, steam primarily, telegraph communication. You had real-time communication across the world in 1914. You just couldn't put much in the message. And you couldn't send images. Which means that pre-1914 globalisation did nothing for the pornography industry, thank God. What's your main energy force? Cheap energy is coal. International rule set, international free trade. Global enforcer, your hegemon, the British Empire. If you defaulted on your government debts before 1914, the Royal Navy would turn up and start shelling your harbours. Or they'd take over your country. Think Egypt. Egypt defaults on its debts in the 1880s. They make a mess building Suez Canal. What do the British do? They take over the Egyptian finance ministry. They're still there in 1945. All the British in the force. Before 1914. The famous case of Dom Pacifico. I love Dom Pacifico, that's a fantastic case. The guy was a Portuguese Jew living in Athens with a fake British passport. There's a riot, his house gets burned down. After his house has got burned down, he puts a claim in to have for damage to his house. The Greek government say, fine, we'll pay it. He then puts in a utterly fraudulent claim for documents he said were in the house. Where's the evidence, says the Greek government? Oh, they got burned. Greek government reasonably says no. British Royal Navy sails into Piraeus Harbour, seizes shipping to the value of this fraudulent claim. Greek government gives in. That's an imperial enforcer. Palmerston, the British Parliament actually thought this was going a bit too far. Lord Palmerston has to defend himself in the British Parliament. Comes out with a famous statement. just as a Roman could go anywhere in the world and say, Q is Romanus sum, and know the legion was behind him. A Brit can go anywhere in the world and say, Q is Britannicus sum, and know the Royal Navy will be behind him. It, by the way, those of you not British, we still have it in our passport, the bit from the foreign minister demanding people look after us. It's just we don't have a navy to enforce it anymore. Globalisation 2.0. Some things haven't changed. We still send most goods around the world by ship, because it's the cheapest. We're using road, right, and plane, technology, electronic engineering, communications, ICT, and cheap energy sources, oil, international rule set, Washington consensus, hegemon, the United States of America. I think we mistook American global hegemony in the 1990s for a process called globalization. We didn't understand what was happening. I personally think globalization is in trouble. So do the Chinese. They've got very good reasons for it. Apart from the fact, you know, we might run out of oil one day. That really will do us. We're utterly dependent on oil. We've not found an alternative. First thing is the decline of the US hegemon. America is not as powerful now as it was in 2000. There's a nice little date there. Does anyone know what, we all know what 9/11 is, yeah, thinking of the American way of doing it. Does anyone who's not one of my economics students know what 11/9 is? 9th of November, 1989. What fell? I said who's not my economics student, yeah?
The wall, no?
Berlin Wall. Mm-hmm. It's lovely, the dates go. You go from 11/9 to 9/11. Is that the period of American hegemony? Did American hegemony start collapsing with the World Trade Center? Did Osama achieve more than he ever believed? Got very good reasons for thinking so. Iraq was a disaster. When Americans go into Iraq, everyone in the world quivers with fear. Gaddafi hands over his nuclear program, he's so scared, and then the Americans make a mess of the occupation. Their credibility is very badly damaged. Syria. The Russians recently humiliated the Americans in Syria. Obama's red lines. If the Assad government uses chemical weapons, we will intervene. Assad uses chemical weapons. America keeps trying to talk itself up to intervene militarily. The Russians come along and say, look, hey, we'll sort it for you. We can deliver. We'll persuade Assad to give up his chemical. No need to throw any bombs anywhere. Seriously undermine American credibility in the rest of the world. The rest of the world looking at America and saying, okay, they can't deliver in the Middle East anymore. They can't deliver outcomes in the Middle East. Egypt, the same. America's a mess in Egypt. They don't know what they want. They wanted democracy, they thought. Then they thought they'd better get rid of it in a military coup to have real democracy. They're in trouble. Debt ceiling, budget rollover. Everyone talked to me about this in China. What is going on with these people? How can they get within 2 hours of defaulting on their debt, which we Chinese own 50%, by the way? What is it? And they're supposed to be the major global power? They're the global financial power? This is a view from Beijing. We've got real doubts about how credible America is as manager of the global economy, manager of reserve currency in the world. Should the dollar be the reserve currency? The Chinese used to think the euro was an alternative. They don't seem to mention that anymore, for some reason. They're thinking about the day the renminbi becomes the reserve currency in the world. I'm actually thinking about that now. Renminbi. People's currency. The UN. Quite, if you want to talk to your taxi driver. The fact that the debt ceiling's not been solved, we just rolled it over. So it's all going to happen again in January and February. And you go, and the fear of the Chinese is that, well, what happens if they actually get it wrong? If this standoff, you're having standoffs go wrong sometimes. What if it actually goes on? America actually technically defaults on its debt. I mean, nobody really thinks America will default. But even a technical default, the impact on the global economy, devastating. And Iran, look at the agreement that Obama's trying to pull on Iran. If it works, he would have done much to re-establish American authority. If he can't deliver it, it will be a major humiliation. Look at the people lining up in Congress to veto it. He's not got Congress on side. And the Saudis and the Israelis are using all the influence, and the Israelis have lots of moral influence in Congress. The Saudis have lots of financial interests influencing Congress. They're lining up the Republican right and the Democratic pro-Israel vote to vote down this moving towards Iran. If this goes wrong, America is in serious problem, because it's tried to solve a problem and failed. It has even less authority. And bear in mind the big feeling in America that Americans would like to go home. A friend of mine who's a professor at the University of Minnesota, who's a Brit, but he said, can you put it like this, it's rather nice. He said, we keep complaining about the American driver of the bus. We're all in the bus is roaring along the road, and we can keep complaining about our American driver. And none of us have noticed he got off at the last stop. We used that one on the Chinese, and they sat there. Holla, holla. Okay, there were some rules there. These rules that we've had governing international trade, international commerce, international economic relations, international political relations, they are Western, they're European, and they come out of the particular historical contingency we call Europe. Because Europe is unique, Europe is weird, Europe is very strange compared to the rest of the world. Which is the most powerful, which is the most powerful state in Europe in 1500? Anyone know? Spain doesn't exist till 1508.
Austria.
Austria.
Nah.
Poland.
Ottoman Empire.
Thank you, it's the Ottoman Empire. It's the Ottoman Empire. Europe's a disaster. It's a bunch of rather thuggish people, very, very uncultured, murdering each other in religious wars on the northwest bit of the Eurasian continent. And if you're looking at a global level, the Ottoman Empire doesn't even cut it. It's Ming Dynasty China. It's Mughal Empire India. Even the Ebu in Nigeria, technically, were ahead of the Europeans at the time. And yet, 300 years later, Europe runs the world. And even at the end of the 20th century, European rule sets still dominate the world. It's America's European project. America's the ultimate culmination of European political debates. How did it happen? Well, it happens from the peculiarities of geography and, above all, geopolitics. The big difference between Europe and every other region of the world is no single European state ever unified Europe. Every time a European state tried to unify Europe, the rest of Europe united to block it. This is one of the reasons whenever you go to international relations schools in Europe or the United States of America, they spend the entire time talking about balance of power. Because balance of power is how Europe runs. So when Spain tried to dominate Europe in the 16th, 17th century, they get blocked by the British, the French, what's left of the Austrian, Hungarian, the Holy Roman Empire, neither Holy nor Roman nor an empire. But it gets blocked. When the Ottoman Turks, even in the 17th century, the last Ottoman siege of Vienna is 1628, I think. And the Poles come in to block them, stop them taking over. Then the French want to dominate. And they get blocked by the British and the Spanish and the Prussians. And then, of course, the Germans have a couple of goes. And they get blocked by everybody. The only people who never try it are the British. Because the British sit off on that rather damp, foggy island, enjoying the fun. That's why nobody trusts Britain. Because every time one country becomes powerful, Britain stops supporting it, and then goes and stops supports the second most powerful country to block it. Again, quoting Lord Palmerston, we have no permanent friends and no permanent enemies. We have only permanent duties, which is the duty, permanent interests, sorry, which it is the duty of this government to pursue. It remains the same. You ask about the French, about British behaviour in the European Union, after the war. What this means is you've got a series of sovereign states constantly in competition with each other. Competition militarily, competition commercially, competition politically. And that competition drives innovation. It drives technological innovation. It drives military innovation. It drives managerial innovation. If you get develop new weapons to go and fight with, you have to develop new ways of organising your army to use them. That drives you into new governmental innovation. Got to raise the money to pay for it. You can tell the story of European democracy through the fiscal requirements to raise money to pay for armies. You can walk it through 17th century England. King is executed because of this debate about who pays for the army, and if you pay for the army, who controls it? The spread of democracy is entirely about ever more expensive armies, meaning that ever more people have to pay taxes, and ever more people paying taxes insist that they get a say in how the money gets spent. And if you want to look at the outbreak of the Civil War in England, it's fundamentally about who does the British Army go and kill? And Parliament says Spain, and the King says Scotland. I made no comment, my wife is Scotland. American Revolution. What's American Revolution about? Actually, American Revolution is a really interesting lesson for Spain and Catalonia. It's about fiscal autonomy. No taxation without representation. The Americans wanted fiscal autonomy. They would have settled for fiscal autonomy. They ended up with independence by mistake, because both sides were so monumentally incompetent in handling the conversation about fiscal autonomy. Senor Massey, Senor Rajoy might like to study the more detailed histories of the American War of Independence, or the American Revolution, to avoid similar mistakes. What this means in terms of relationships among states about rule sets is you develop rule sets on the basis of independent sovereign states of equal status. International relations, international political relations, international commercial relations. The rules are developed to deal with these relationships. Rules of non-interference, Treaty of Westphalia, 1648. States do not have the right to interfere in the internal affairs of other states. Non-interference, basic principle of international relations, right through until the last 25 years. So these rule sets come from European historical contingency. They make no sense in China, because China was unified by the Han and has remained, apart from every now and then it fragments into a civil war, but has made a unified state ever since. Russia unified the whole of its territory. It's only in Europe that these small states remained in competition with each other. That's why they became dominant in the world, because their technology was so good. I used to joke with students, why did Europe dominate the world? Because we like killing better more than anyone else. We're better killers. Well, there's an element to it. Europeans go to China, China have invented gunpowder, what do they do with it? They make fireworks! And we go along and say, hey, we could really kill people with that. We could kill a lot of people with that. And we go back and kill the Chinese through the 19th century. They've not forgotten, by the way. They will never forget. These rule sets are fragmenting. As soon as you no longer have the hegemon who's enforcing the rule sets begin to fragment. As we're getting other emerging powers, the emerging powers are saying, or advancing alternative rule sets, alternative value systems. And I say other emerging powers and rule sets and systems in the plural deliberately. This is where I attack the concept of the BRICS. Some lunatic in Morgan Stanley or wherever it was, third-rate investment banker with limited IQ, came up with the BRICS because it seemed a cool thing to say. Well, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, the BRICS. If somebody could tell me what, apart from the fact that their economies are growing, they have in common with each other, I would be delighted to know. Russia is a country utterly dependent on oil sales. If oil prices go down, Russia goes. Brazil, whole variety of raw materials and a fairly diversified economy. China, a manufacturing country that goes to Brazil to try and get their raw materials out of them. India, biggest parliamentary democracy in the world. Brazil, flawed, but a democracy. Russia, a pretty unpleasant dictatorship and getting more unpleasant by the day. China, a single party authoritarian state. They've got nothing in common. And when it comes to the values, the way that they see the world and the world's developing, they're all advancing different agendas. Their agendas are different. China's agenda is very different to India's agenda. And one day the Chinese Navy is going to meet the Indian Navy in the middle of the South China Sea. And it won't be nice. Bao Conference, 2009. Here, China. We've got to China at last. We'll go away from it again. We'll go back to China. Bao Conference. We have Davos, don't we? Yeah? The World Economic Forum. I love the World Economic Forum. We mean the West's Economic Forum. In Davos, and we hold it in the mountains, and it's cold, and it's snowy, and there's lots of skiing. Well, the Bao Conference is a Chinese version. It's a Chinese economic forum. They call it the Asian Economic Forum. They play the same game as us. They hold theirs in Hainan, which is low, hot, tropical and sticky. And every year, European bankers went to the Bao conference to tell the Chinese how to organise their banks. You know, we know about banking, we know about banking. In 1960, in 2009, they went there, this guy, a banker, stood there and told them to get lost. We don't want to learn about your banking system. Why do you learn about your banking system? Is it so good? You know, are you really experts in banking? Lehman Brothers. Do you really know how to regulate the global financial system? You had this idiot Greenspan keeping interest rates so low to drive an asset price bubble that then collapses and nobody saw it coming, and you're coming telling us about how to drive the global economy. By the way, who's the only country that's not actually collapsed of late? Oh, it's us, isn't it? With our flawed Chinese banking system. They got it in the net, one after another. The Chinese said, we don't want any more American banking knowledge, American banking system, Western banking system in China. We can do it ourselves, thank you, and we're better at it than you are. And one of the discourses you will hear, there's a very interesting book by a man called Zhang Weiwei, called The China Way. Zhang Weiwei was Deng Xiaoping's interpreter. He's now a professor at Fudan. He's written this very interesting book in which he talks about China's view as well. And he starts off by saying, look, we've done all these things so much nicer and so much better than you did. Look at our growth path. Look how our economy is growing. When your economic group was growing that speed, you were killing half the world. When you went trading around the world, you conquered people, enslaved them. We just trade with them. All right, so we strip their assets. But we don't kill them at the same time. We can let the environment do that. So there's an increasing confidence saying, well, so are you so great at this stuff? You experts? You're coming and telling us what to do? It's a really interesting example about the world, the way it's changing. It's particularly relevant because we've just seen that, you know, poor old Repsol's been having his arm broken to sign an agreement, awful agreement, with the Argentine government, for various internal reasons, for the Kaish and the Spanish government, US government, will want Repsol to sign up and get out of it. But think what happened. Really interesting story. Argentina expropriates YPF. 10 years ago, all the textbooks on geopolitical risk for companies, I know, because I used to sort of review some, they all said that you didn't need to worry about these problems anymore. Nobody expropriates anymore. Nobody nationalizes anymore. That's the old, bad old world. We're in the world of the World Trade Organization. We're in the world of rules. International rules says you don't do things like this. And if anybody tries it, we crucify them. They can't sell. They can't go to any bank in the world. We'll isolate them completely. Well, the trouble is, Argentina expropriates YPF and nothing happens. Repsol goes to the Spanish government and says, can you do something about this? The Spanish government says, whoa, hang on. We've got Telefonica down in Argentina, we've got Santander, we've got BBV. You know, if we get too cross, they might do something nasty to them as well. Not ever occurring to them, actually, what they've done is give a license to every Latin American country that wants to expropriate foreign company, give the Spanish ones, because nothing happens. Argentina was clever. They noticed that the rules had changed. So the next thing that Argentina does is invite the Chinese Wen Jiabao, the Chinese Prime Minister, on a visit to Buenos Aires. He's now moved on, he's now at Li Keqiang. But the Wen Jiabao is invited on a visit to Buenos Aires. They don't actually talk about YPF. Not formally. But in the press conferences, it's raised, rather to the bemusement of Wen Jiabao, who's standing there thinking, I didn't talk about that, did I? But it's raised. Why? Because Argentina's not talking to him. They're talking to Washington. They know that Washington is really worried about the massive Chinese presence in Latin America. They know that Washington is thinking about the old Monroe Doctrine. Latin America is the US's backyard. Other countries don't mess. So what happens? Chevron is authorized and encouraged by the Obama administration go and sign a deal with YPF to explore and develop the Bakunwetter gas field. Repsol is dead, which is why Repsol now has to accept this terrible deal, which I understand may even be paid in. It's a fantastic deal, I don't know if you've seen the detail. The rumour is that Repsol is going to be paid in 10-year Argentine government bonds at 3%. You can buy Spanish government bonds at 4.25%. If Argentina puts ever gets to the financial markets, which is still questionable, they'll be looking at 5 or 6% on their bonds. But Repsol gets left with the deal. The interesting thing about this for me, though, is showing both how the rule set is breaking down, and how a country like Argentina can play off big powers like China and the US in pursuing its objectives. It's a very different world. Breakdown of the fragmentation of the rule sets goes together with the stagnation of international institutions. International institutions, there's a secret about them that nobody likes to admit, but international institutions freeze the geopolitical power balance of the moment of their birth, which means that they're always unfit for purpose. The United Nations freezes the geopolitical realities of 1945, which is why the Charter has got nothing about humanitarian intervention. Even though the General Assembly has adopted this resolution on right on the duty to protect, that's still not in the Charter. If you want to use military intervention according to the UN Charter, you've got to say it's a threat to international peace and security, which internal genocide is not. It's written to deal with the world. The World Trade Organization, even clearer example, the World Trade Organization is created in 1995 at the height of American hegemony. It reflects American power and American commercial rules. Has it done anything since 2000? Nothing. China entered the World Trade Organization in 2000. China has not complied with any of the rules it was supposed to comply with, and nothing's happened. The Doha round is dead. Everyone sort of tries to pretend it's still going on, the new round of trade talks, but it won't happen. Again, it's something that was of its moment. Really interesting one about this is the internet. Internet is an international institution. Came into being in 1995. We could not have had an internet, global internet, in 1985. If we tried it in 1985, we'd have had a Soviet internet, a Chinese internet, and a Western internet, and probably a French internet. And all of them would have been incompatible. The French even tried to have their own internet in the 90s. I can't remember what it was called. Minitel. Yeah. Last fight of De Gaulle spirit. You wouldn't get a global internet now. If you tried to do it now, you'd have a Chinese internet, you'd have a Russian internet, various other internets, France would try again, you'd have a Western internet, and they'd be incompatible. It was that one moment in the mid-90s where American hegemony was so powerful that no one could resist it. And a lot of people now regret that. They're trying to find ways of clawing control back. The international economic institutions reflect Western rule sets. They're no longer relevant. Which raises the issue, if our international institutions don't work, and the UN, forget it, the last thing that the UN actually did, effectively, was Libya, and we in the West lied. We lied to the Chinese, we lied to the Russians about what that resolution was for. We said it was to support humanitarian operations. We used it for regime change. We will never be forgiven, and we will never be allowed to pull another stunt like that. And we're back to the old days. I have possibly the only, I don't know, maybe someone else. I think I'm possibly the only person in this room who's ever voted in the Security Council. And that was by mistake. As a very junior diplomat, I worked in New York. I was sitting in the Security Council, and the ambassador got lost in traffic. And these were the days where, we forget what it's like with no mobile telephones. And the ambassador had the instructions on how to vote, and I'm sitting there, slightly terrified, waiting for him. And the Soviet ambassador calls for the vote, the presiding Security Council. I said, how do I vote? We're in the Cold War, it's really easy. Whichever way the Soviets vote, I go the other way. We're back then. Okay. Let's start thinking about China in the world. What is China like in the world? This guy Zhang Weiwei talks about China as a civilizational power. It's not a nation state. It's an entire civilization. There's no civilizational power in Europe, unless the European Union ever becomes a power, which I doubt. We have lots of different powers, but within one Western civilization. And I say it's America, it's part of the same civilization. None of them represents a civilization as a whole. China does. That means that China sees the world in a very different way. We all joke about China being the Middle Kingdom. But bear in mind, that is the name of China. For the Chinese, China is Zhongguo. Zhongguo means the central kingdom. China comes from our misapprehension of Chinese history, from the Qin dynasty. We use the word from the Qin dynasty to apply to Chinese. They don't apply to themselves. They talk about themselves being the people of the middle kingdom, Zhongguo Ren. The formal title of China is Zhonghua Renmin Gonghuo, the Chinese people, the middle kingdom's people's republic. This is quite an interesting idea. It comes from Stratfor. Stratfor is one of the American geopolitical analysis organizations. And the idea is to float China off and see what China looks like. I quite like this. I remember going to East Berlin during the Cold War and going into a government office there, and they had the Soviet map of the world. Now, we had our map of the world, which had the Soviet Union was over there somewhere, looking pretty threatening to Western Europe. And, you know, Britain was pretty central, but little island. But when you looked at the Soviet map, you realised that the Soviet Union was surrounded by enemies. Just ringed by enemies. You understood their paranoia. If you put Russia, put Moscow right at the centre of your map, and your Soviet strategist looking, you started thinking, it's not a nice place to be, it's not a nice world to live in. Well, China has a similar position. If you start looking at China and what China's surrounded by, you see a series of countries, and I'm sorry, the map doesn't come out very well, but that are pretty hostile. Japan is seen as a hostile state by China. Korea is seen as a hostile state by China. India is a hostile state. Russia is a semi-hostile state. So Chinese strategic concerns need to be seen in that context. They're in the middle, but around them are not friendly states. Because of this idea of the civilizational state and being the central kingdom, they have no concept of international relations. There aren't international relations in China, because international relations come from the European experience of small sovereign states that are equal with each other. Thus, you have equal relations with them, equal states, equal relations. Thus, China's concept, you can't have equal relations if you're the central kingdom and you're the civilizational state. And when they're looking around Vietnam, and sorry, they're looking at Japan and Korea, the Chinese will always turn around, as you know, many of you will know, and say, yeah, well, they just stole our culture. And they'll point to kanji, and they'll point to the way that Korean used to be written. They point to the use of Confucian classics in surrounding cultures. And they'll assert a cultural superiority, which is really important for them. What this results in is a concept of tributary relations. Relations are based on the tribute that other states pay to China. Your position depends on your position in the China system. States are rated according to are they near or far, or very far. And this comes, as I said, comes out of a different historical contingency. There's a big argument in the West. Fukuyama, who wrote his book The End of History in 1991 with the fall and collapse of the Cold War, and I came to the idea that there is a single path to modernity, that inevitably you go through a democratic state, you go to this, you go to that, and you end up where we are in the West now. The Chinese deny that. They say that is just the particular contingency of being European and your love of killing each other. We got to modernity by a different path and a completely different view of the world. And possibly the most clearest case of this is poor old George McCarthy, who was sent to China as ambassador for George III. George III had his wonderful idea of establishing diplomatic relations between Britain and China. Diplomatic relations is what he wanted. So McCarthy said, and he spent a great time travelling all over up through China. He goes with his delegation with wonderful gifts for the Chinese, to latest British technology. You know, Britain's in the Industrial Revolution, producing fantastic technology, you know, the equivalent of the iPad Plus. No one else is anywhere near it. And the first thing he has to negotiate is whether he's going to kowtow or not, because everyone has to kowtow to the emperor. And kowtow is lying face down on the ground and banging your head. Arms out, bang your head 9 times. Kowtow means to bang your head. And McCarthy said, I can't do it. I'm the representative of George III. I'm the representative of His Majesty. We don't do things like that. And eventually they agree he can do what he would do to George III, go down on one knee. And this is the cartoon of him going down on one knee before, or rather, actually is one of the great Chinese emperors. Our Western cultural prejudices. And he makes a request to establish a customs office and to establish diplomatic relations with China. And on the way, nothing happens. And he eventually has to go back. So on his way back, finally he gets a letter from the emperor, which is written in a very patronising way, saying that it would be impossible to have relations between China and Britain, because Britain is a very small country, very far away. Nevertheless, the emperor is delighted that the king of this small country has now agreed to pay tribute to the Chinese emperor and become part of the system. However, trade would really be irrelevant, because having seen the paltry gifts that the ambassador came with, Britain really doesn't have anything that China needs. The Chinese view of the world. We never got it, but it's still there, still happening. I remember there's a lovely story at the beginning of the 19th century. All the factory owners in Manchester came to the conclusion if they could all sell one shirt to China, they would be billionaires. The trade went so badly, our balance of payment, particularly India's balance of payments, was so awful because of all the silks and teas we were buying from China, the silver outflows, and they weren't buying a single shirt, of course, that we had to invent the drugs trade to balance the books. We had to convert the Chinese into opium addicts to balance the accounts, which is what we did. And we got Hong Kong. And when you look at Standard Chartered and you look at Hong Kong Shanghai Bank, who were the banks of the Scottish drug smugglers operating at the time? It would be like in the future having the Medellin Bank and the Cali Bank as the great banks of international finance. We operated at that kind of level. And it's true today. I still keep encountering businessmen who are absolutely convinced that all they've got to do is go and trade in China and they'll get rich. And they won't. The Chinese, we don't have anything they want. We do actually. At the top end, they will buy Bentleys from us. They will buy the best Audis. They'll buy the best wine. But everything else, they'll invite us in, be very nice to us, copy the technology and make it themselves. A friend of mine works for a company called Omothable. I don't know if you've seen, do you know Omothable? They're a power switching company in the Basque Country. They switch power from very high voltage levels to normal levels for ordinary lights. So it's a lovely story. They were in China, and they started producing locally, and they found it being copied, and all this stuff being copied. And they complained. And the Chinese said, what are you complaining about? You should be flattered. We only copy the best. And the guy from Omothable, high Omothable, the president, said, well, where's our market? Oh, no, you've got a market. Because at the high end of the party, and the high end of the army, they want the original, not our copies. But that's your market. If you complain about it, you lose it. So they now make in the Basque Country to the very high level, and they know that the normal level is going to be made in China by Chinese. We have to get used to Chinese culture if we want to do business with them. And too many businessmen have no idea. Now, what about China in the world? How did China react under US hegemony? By the way, this is a guy who did what Obama tried to do, and he pulled it off. But then it's rather easier. If you're tricky-dicky with your reputation as an anti-communist right-wing hardliner, it's much easier to re-establish relations with communist China and establish détente with the Soviet Union, because the right-wing anti-communists have got nowhere to go, have they, really? Obama's got a much harder task. One of the things that strikes me about China under US hegemony is that the Chinese were very happy with it. It didn't mind the Western rule set as long as the Americans were implementing it, because it meant they didn't have to take responsibility. They could do their trading, they could get rich, they could develop their economy, but there was no need for them to take on the responsibility of where the global economy was going. They didn't have to manage the problems. They knew the Americans would do it for them. It's a sense in which the Chinese were not unhappy with that arrangement. The only thing that they didn't like was the extent to which the West started abandoning its own rules. Ironically, the Chinese quite liked the Western rule set. They particularly liked that bit about non-intervention in domestic affairs. When you talk to Chinese diplomats, they'll say, look, we are the ultimate defenders of the Treaty of Westphalia. You guys have forgotten about it. We defend it. the internal affairs of a country are nothing to do with other countries. That's how you maintain international peace and security, not by messing around. Look what happened in Afghanistan. Look what happened in Iraq. And particularly, they tell the story about Iraq. You guys went into Iraq, you toppled Saddam, you removed a Sunni minority government in a Shia majority country. Iraq is now aligned with Iran, therefore the Saudis have got to do the same in Syria to balance it up. Was your intervention a great contribution to international peace and security? Are the Iraqi people really better off being blown up by Saudi-financed al-Qaeda terrorists on a daily basis? So there's an irony there that actually the Chinese end up the great defenders of the Western system. Of course, they have their own reasons for it. They don't want us talking about Tibet, they don't want us talking about Mongolia, and they definitely don't want us talking about Tiananmen Square. Which I will talk about. China's strategy. What's China's strategy? China has an internal issue. Post Tiananmen, there was an unwritten deal between the Chinese government, the Chinese Communist Party, and the Chinese people. For me, one of the most interesting things about Tiananmen, it's fascinating being on the square, but body counting and tank spotting has limitations in terms of being interested. It's an experience. But the more interesting thing was talking to the Chinese liberals I knew afterwards. People who I'd seen out demonstrating, who all turned around and said, "You realise how near we got to at the end? Do you realise how near we got to it collapsing? We looked into the abyss and we stepped back just at the last moment." And certainly it's true, after Tiananmen Square in Beijing for those 3 or 4 days from the 1st to the 8th of June, when you walked around Beijing, you had the impression that there was a civil war coming. That the army was deployed not to take on students or protesters, but to take on another Chinese army unit. We were getting intelligence reports of other army units approaching Beijing, which later moved away again. They got really close. But the Chinese are obsessed with stability. You can understand why. If you look at Chinese history from 1800 onwards, it's a horror story of uprisings, rebellions, massacres, famines. Even if you look since 1949, great leap forward, something like 40 million dead in 6 months of starvation. Cultural Revolution, 2 or 3 million dead, at least, probably more. So for the Chinese, stability is the key. There's the old joke about the Chinese curse, may you live in interesting times. I think I answered last time, I'm an Anglo-Irishman, I like interesting times. But not for the Chinese. So the deal is offered. If the Communist Party can guarantee economic growth, if the Communist Party can guarantee social and political stability, then it can stay in power. Then Tiananmen will never be raised. There will never be a call for more democracy. That's the unwritten deal between the Chinese people. The majority of the Chinese people are very happy with that deal, but the government's got to deliver. It puts the government under enormous pressure to deliver continuous economic growth. Calculation is that to keep the show on the road, they need to be delivering growth between 7 and 8%. At the moment, they're on the low side. 7.4%. Anyway, 7.4%. Be nice and spend. We dream of 7%. They get 7% and they start getting out the riot gear. They're concerned about the crisis. Bear in mind what happened in China 2009, in the middle of the crisis. They start worrying about factories closing down in Shanghai and Beijing. They deploy the army to stop people coming back from Chinese New Year. Because they reckon it's better to have 2,000 unemployed in this village, 1,000 unemployed in that village, than have 10 million unemployed in Shanghai on the streets. And the strategy is also to keep a low international profile. China does not veto in the Security Council. Almost never. They abstain. They always try and get someone to veto for them. The Russians usually oblige. But even during the Cold War, the Chinese tended not to veto. They'd hide behind the Soviet veto. They've been very much low profile up until now on the big international issues. And then you get the other side, actual practical, what they're doing. They're securing their energy resources, which is why they've basically bought Brazil. They've bought Africa. Coming and buying Spain at the moment, by the way. To secure raw materials. Again, Indonesia, Brazil, Latin America in general, Africa in general, to protect their transport routes. Now, this is a new one, but they're developing a navy. They've just built their first aircraft carriers. They know that they've got to protect those routes. This is one of the problems. If the American hegemon goes home, each power has to start protecting its own interests. We've relied on the Americans to deal with piracy, not to deal with fighting each other countries, but to deal with fighting the asymmetric threats, piracy, terrorists, and the like. We've been relying on the Americans. The Chinese have been relying on the Americans. The Chinese conclude the Americans are not going to deliver anymore. And then it gets dangerous, because then the Chinese building a blue water fleet and the Indians building a blue water fleet. At some point, somewhere around about the Malacca Straits, they bump into each other. The world gets more dangerous. Keeping their currency very weak. We discussed this a couple of weeks ago. The Chinese keep their currency very weak, which has driven many of the problems we've got, the imbalances in global capital flows, which lie behind much of the crisis in America, being driven by the Chinese keeping their currency low, maintaining a persistent surplus on their current account year after year after year, not allowing it to balance off. Although the irony is, if you look at their imports, energy and raw material imports, February this year, China was in deficit on the current account. They ran a one-month deficit on the current account, and nobody could believe it. What's going on? The Chinese New Year. They stopped producing for 2 weeks. Such a level of imports, the energy and the raw materials, they have to import to keep the show running. They stopped producing for 2 weeks, they're in a deficit on the current account. They've got some problems. And developing major international companies. If you look at top 10 banks, I think 5 are Chinese. Companies like Huawei, like Sinopec, like Citi, these are the big players at an international level. They're dwarfing our companies. China challenges. Demographics for China, 2010-2025. They're not good. The first thing we notice is it's great being a girl in China, you get a choice. And girls, if you want to have an exciting private life, China's a country to live. Because there are lots of frustrated boys, you can take your pick. The result of the one-child policy. This is all about... Yeah, we give a lot of criticism to one-child policy, saying how unfair it was, how wrong it was. They had no choice. Look what Mao had done. This is Mao in the 50s and 60s, telling the Chinese to breed so that they'll survive a nuclear war. Famous conversation of Mao with Khrushchev in 1961, when they're in Beijing and they're in the swimming pool because Khrushchev, Mao loves swimming, and he knows that Khrushchev can't swim. So poor Khrushchev's in a rubber ring. Not very dignified. And Mao is swimming around him. Mao said, yeah, see the nuclear war. It's a paper tiger. Famous phrase, it's a paper tiger. He said, okay, we have a nuclear war with the Americans. They kill 300 million Chinese. We'll still have 400 million left, we win. Khrushchev kind of thinking, this guy makes me look balanced. Khrushchev goes back, cancels all collaboration with China, including nuclear collaboration, immediately, where the Sino-Soviet split comes from. We in the West were so well informed, we don't notice it for the 5 years. Their problem is aging population. We think we've got aging population problems in Europe. Look at that aging population. They had to do something about it. They couldn't have gone to a population of 2 billion, which was what was being projected, 2 to 2.5 billion with the projections at the end of the Cultural Revolution. Can't feed them. So they had to introduce the one-child policy, but look at the problem it's causing. That's their aging policy. This has got to support that. That's one of their problems. They've got a whole series of problems. The Chinese economy doesn't function on a market basis. So Chinese companies are able to produce below cost in domestic markets. There's no bankruptcy. There's no discipline on companies. So companies are able to sell at a low cost. That means that all domestic markets are already saturated with goods. Where does the money come from? The banks keep giving out the money. Where does the banks get the money from? The government keeps giving the banks the money. At some point, that's going to have to stop. The loose monetary policy, which also enables them to keep their currency very low, has also driven a massive asset price bubble. It's making the American housing bubble look quite modest. That's going to have to correct it sometime. They've still got to deal with the problem between the massive difference of income between the coasts and the inland. Being in Beijing, apart from the pollution, I left Beijing coming back to Spain thinking that Madrid was a third world country. All right, it didn't help him out with the strike with the Basura and the Basura reinforced. But hey, you're on the metro in Beijing, are you going along? And they're projecting the adverts on the wall of the tunnel. Okay, I can't actually see what the use of that is, but it's a pretty impressive piece of technology. It's kind of cool. Everywhere, you live 50 to 100 miles outside Beijing, you're back in the Middle Ages. They've got to deal with that problem. So they've got a lot of internal challenges they've got to deal with, and when they get able to deal with them is open to question. China remains a very fragile country. They've got to keep that growth rate at 7.5% to keep the show on the road. They've got to confront these challenges reorganising their banking sector. One of their biggest challenges is to create a domestic consumption market. They're still highly dependent on export. Now, they've got population 1.3 billion. That should be a pretty impressive domestic consumption market. Look at this proposal for, what's it called, TAFTA? Transatlantic Free Trade Area. Transatlantic Free Trade Area, at its maximum, will be 800 million. Maximum, I think it's actually less, 770 million. China's domestic market is 1.3 billion and rising. How can they get people to spend money? Well, their problem is they have no welfare system. Because in a communist country, you don't need a welfare system. First of all, you don't need unemployment benefit, because in communism, you don't have unemployment. It's been abolished in the workers' paradise. But also, you don't have free education, you don't have free healthcare, because this is all dealt with through your work unit. In Chinese, called a dan wei. And you belong to a dan wei. And that pays your clothing. That pays for your medical care. It pays for your education. It pays for your food. As soon as internal transfers, internal markets, pay for everything. Once you abolish the dan wei system, you introduce capitalism, suddenly the workers don't have any of that. There's no free education system, as you have in Western capitalist countries. Because in Western capitalist countries, we got this idea from Bismarck in the 1880s, and it was reinforced by Ford and Taylorism, that you need to develop social protection so that the people will spend money. Because if you don't have social protection, people don't spend money. Why don't they spend money? Well, they might lose their job tomorrow. They've got to get their kids through school, through university. By the way, we should be really terrified for our kids. The hunger among Chinese university students is terrifying. And they're all at least bilingual, and they're all getting top grades, and they're willing to do our kids' work for half the wages. We should be really concerned. So there's a range of the problems that China's got to deal with, the challenges internally. But China's in a world of transition, and this is where the thing about the buses coming and being on the bus with no driver. The Chinese are finally noticing that this multipolar world that they've been talking about and talking up might be about to happen. We're not there yet, but we're not in a unipolar world anymore. And if you're in a really multipolar world, and the Americans are unable or unwilling to take on the responsibility for governing it, then as China, you have to start taking on your responsibilities. It becomes uncomfortable. And they're beginning to realise this, beginning to feel rather uncomfortable. If the Chinese are saying that the rules of the game and institutions don't work, then you've got to get new rules and institutions. But it won't be easy anymore. I told you how the British did in the 19th century. They just went and shelled people. Royal Navy turns up and bombs your harbour. You accept the rule set. The Americans were able to do it through the 90s with drones. Okay, don't mess with the Americans. You American rule set? Fine. Okay, Uncle Sam, not a problem. But China now is not in that position, nor is India, nor is Brazil, nor is South Africa. They're going to have to negotiate new rule sets. It's never been done before, or not in the period of any period of global trade and global interconnectedness. Going back to the previous period, and I said, perhaps I should say, we're probably in globalization 3.0, with a very Eurocentric view. You said the first globalization was the Roman Empire. Again, the Romans imposed the rules. They didn't negotiate the rules to anybody. This starts getting new challenges, a much more complicated process. Developing new diplomacy. China haven't really done diplomacy. They don't believe in international relations. So why do diplomacy? Chinese companies have been clumsy. One of the interesting discussions, I ended up writing an article for a Chinese newspaper about how Western companies got pretty clumsy, particularly in Latin America and Africa, going, particularly mining companies, going to extract the raw materials you want. You don't care about the local community. The local communities start complaining, they start mounting campaigns, start saying, we want schools, please, we want hospitals, will you start providing what we want? And when the Chinese companies first arrived, everybody thought that they would be a better alternative to the West. After all, they're not West. And they came with propaganda, we're from China, we understand you people. We are third world like you. We're an emerging economy like you. But now they're finding the Chinese companies are as bad as anybody else. In some cases worse, because the idea of corporate social responsibility never occurs to them. There's a lovely story about the first Chinese company that went into America in the late 70s. Of course, big American company, sacked all the workers. First thing was sack everyone. Then re-recruited only non-union employees. An American said to me, no American company, no great capitalist American company would have dared to do that. Only communists can do things like that. They've got themselves a bad reputation around the world. And they need to find ways. In many parts of the world, it's the Chinese firms that create the bad reputation for the government, for China as a whole. Think what's happening in Spain with the Chinese taking over the funerals, appropriately, but taking over the textile shops, taking over Lavapiés. The comments you get from people about the Chinese takeover, the Chinese coming, the nervousness it creates because the relationships are not being managed. And then they've got the problem, the regional tensions we saw today. The Chinese have announced the effectively what they would like to call a no-fly or a limited-fly zone of the Diaoyu Islands. Or I'm really guilty here now, I can't remember the Japanese name, which shows it, I'm a Chinese speaker. But over the Diaoyu Islands. The Americans put a plane over, of course, trying to let the plane go over. But these kind of regional tensions, there's serious regional tensions China's got that it needs to manage with India, with Burma, with Japan, with Korea, with North Korea. And these are going to require a greater development of diplomatic skills, greater development of the concept of international relations. So what are the prospects? They've got to deal with the internal problems. We had a discussion with the grade 11 students last year. Well, they're now grade 11, they were then grade 10. What languages should you learn? Everyone's already learned Mandarin Chinese. Yeah, and if China collapses tomorrow? And China can. If you look at all the problems that it's got, probably just as well as not a democracy. They have a major problem with cultural insensitivity. It's causing big problems in Africa. One of the problems they've got in Africa is the Chinese will come in and they'll do a project for you. And they will build a road, correct? And they'll build bring Chinese workers in. And Chinese technology. And then they take Chinese technology away again. And they take Chinese workers away. And you get the road, but nothing else. You get no technology transfer, you get no employment creation, you just get the road. And African countries are getting increasingly concerned about this. They say, hang on, we let them get all our raw materials and they do that to us. What do we get? A road. If we let the West come in, the West will do technology transfer, they do a whole range of other things. And things like racism, the Chinese can be as racist as the West can be racist. And these are causing problems. We've seen problems in Africa, we've seen problems in Latin America. And it's one of the issues that they're talking about. We talked a lot about business diplomacy when I was there. Possibility of doing some more work with more business diplomacy, because they're really interested in this. How do businesses do diplomacy? How do businesses act like diplomats to try and lower these tensions, to avoid these conflicts, to deal with these cultural, multicultural sensitivity? You've got the conflict of commercial interests and political interests. And we always think that China is, you know, one government, it's all one strategy around the world. There's temptation. I mean, I've fallen into the past. This is why I say, well, the great thing about the Chinese, they've got one strategy, the government tells the firms what to do, the firms act on behalf of the government, isn't it great? But actually, you've got lots of Chinese firms who have their own agendas. And the Chinese Communist Party Central Committee people I was talking to were complaining about these firms who go ahead pursuing their narrow commercial agendas, undermining China's political agenda. If China is trying to create a reputation as a responsible operator in the world that's able to be taken seriously in generating new rule sets, new international institutions, it doesn't help if their companies are crashing around, pursuing that very narrow short-term interest. And the last one is interesting. Pafta Pafta. Pafta Pafta Nafta. Sounds like a children's television series in Britain. Here is Dafta, and here's Nafta, and they're playing. Tafta is really interesting. And it may not happen. I've got everything that Congress will block it if the French don't. But the idea of a transatlantic free trade area, why are we doing that? My interpretation is that we're giving up on globalisation. We're giving up on international institutions. Because if we've got the World Trade Organization genuinely promoting international free trade, why do we need Tafta? And who's it against? Who's not going to be invited to join? Look at Tafta, Pacific free trade area. Japan's been invited to join. Korea's been invited to join. I think Indonesia and the Philippines have been invited to talk. But China's not invited and won't be invited. Mm-hmm. One of the big challenges for China is the extent to which the Americans, going home, have decided to create defensive free trade areas, a network of defensive free trade areas, to defend their interests. It's like we're going into a world where our universal values, our values are no longer universal, our rule sets are no longer universal, therefore we will start limiting trade to those who do accept our rules. Now you may say your maximal strategy of that is if we do that, then the Chinese will eventually have to join in. The minimal strategy is that actually the Chinese don't join in because the Chinese have a market that's bigger than Tafta. If they start trading with the Indians, they've got a market that's bigger than Tafta, Pafta, Wafta, Bafta, and Zafta all put together. And then actually we are the ones who lose. And this is why I'm a firm believer that globalisation is finished. What we call globalisation during the 1990s is over. What we're seeing is increasing regionalisation. And if you want to know who took the lead in fragmenting globalisation, it was of course in Europe, with the European Union. The European Union was a move against international free trade. Ask African farmers. They weren't allowed to trade with us because French farmers, British farmers, Spanish farmers must be protected. So that is going to be a challenge. How will China react to that? And how will China engage with these conflicts that are going around the world? And here we see some of the responses that have been revealed. There was a central CCP, Chinese Communist Party. Everyone says PCP now, but I'm very old-fashioned. This one was used to call it CCP, Chinese Communist Party. They created a new International Security Commission precisely to take on these international challenges, being created within the party, working immediately under the Central Committee. Deregulation of their commercial sector, including trying to get foreign investment and get foreign companies coming in to modernise certain commercial sectors and to get companies going bankrupt. But this is promised, it's not happening yet. This is the aspiration. One child policy they're going to change, they had to change one child policy. The limited change, you're going to go to a two-child policy. That's not replacement rate. Replacement rate is 2.4. And it's going to take 20 years before they get to the labour force. They're still going to have a massive Asian population problem, combined with a massive childhood dependency problem. It's going to set serious problems for them. And they talk about reform of the banking sector, with Chinese characteristics. And I'd like to finish with the email I got when I got back from the member of the International Parliament Central Committee of the Communist Party, who we'd had a sort of emails and I sent him some documents. He came back and said, one of the key things we'd like to talk to you about, Shaun, is the future of diplomacy with Chinese characteristics. Mm-hmm. And he knew I'd remember it, because when I worked in Beijing in the 1980s, the big theme was socialism with Chinese characteristics, which everyone else called capitalism. I found it interesting. Thank you. Any questions, by the way? You can ask questions now, you can ask questions over wine. It's entirely up to you. Yeah?
This increasing anti-globalization trend, is this now going to surely lead to a war?
A man called Norman Angel wrote a book called The Great Illusion. And in The Great Illusion, he writes the extent of global economic interdependence and global trade is such that interstate war is now inconceivable. This book, The Great Illusion by Norman Angell, was published in 1913. War is never impossible, because war arises either because people are seeking war or because people miscalculate. The experience of 1914 with miscalculation is enormous scope for miscalculation. As I said, when the Indian fleet and the Chinese fleet start meeting the Malacca Strait, and each one is trying to guarantee the security of their trade routes through the Malacca Strait, there will be risks of tension. The whole series of regional conflicts that China has with the Philippines, with Vietnam, with Japan, and with the US. China, the US is very worried. The Americans are saying that the Pentagon has been taking so many hits from Chinese hackers, and they're sure they're in, but nothing's ever happened. And the concern in the Pentagon is they're not quite sure if their systems are so good that they can't do anything, or if they've just been getting in and they're waiting for when they want to do it. And they're inclining to the interview. And there's a new concept of internet computer security, or information system security, is don't try and stop people getting in. Assume they're already in and then work out how you protect systems. I suspect that increasingly cyber terrorism, cyber warfare are going to be the challenges. But if you want to do a 9/11 now, how do you do it? You take down air traffic control over New York. Forget 3,000 dead, you'll have 30,000 dead in an hour and a half. No one will have any idea where you're going to hit the cruise missiles. And so, apart from the threats of that kind of warfare, the threat of cyber warfare, and the Chinese are ahead of us, way ahead. First Chinese paper on information warfare using computer systems. They held a conference in the People's Liberation Army in 1991, when I was still in Beijing. I remember writing a report on it. So in that era, they were way ahead. Yeah.
Why do they need to maintain such a huge growth per year? It's 7-8%. Why does that have to be so much?
To maintain the level of economic development for the people.
Really?
To keep, because you're constantly bringing people into the market, and you've constantly got peasants coming from the countryside who want to eat. If you want to be fed, you're trying to feed a population 1.3 billion
yeah.
and growing. You're constantly trying to improve infrastructure. I mean, some of the infrastructure is amazing. I mean, I've not been to Shanghai yet, because you travel at 300 kilometers an hour from the airport to Shanghai, which makes me worry how far the airport is from Shanghai. Quite a long way to justify that. I mean, if we were in Madrid, you'd sort of get on the train and you'd be in Sevilla before you knew what happened. But that's essentially why, that if growth starts dropping under there, they can no longer provide for 1.3 billion people.
Yeah, and the other question I had was, is there no kind of threat of social movement against censorship?
This is one of the big debates, and it was a debate we had when we were there, because social media is useless in China, and they've got their own version of Twitter and Baidu. And this is growing, and usage of it is growing. And at the moment, the Chinese Communist Party seems to be able to maintain the control that they want to maintain. And they're very good at using it on their targets. I mean, perhaps one of the problems I should have mentioned, where it comes to relation to your question about warfare, is the temptation for the Chinese Communist Party to use nationalism that then gets out of control. We've seen that when with the Japanese of the Diaoyu Islands, the government will start egging on a little bit of nationalist feeling, and suddenly Baidu takes over. And you suddenly get this very, very intense nationalistic campaign, remember Nanjing. And the Second World War is not forgotten in China. I mean, it doesn't help that Japan every now and then publishes a rather tactless text that says Nanjing didn't happen. if you are going to do massive rape in a country, please don't film it and then leave the films behind for the Chinese to find afterwards. One of the things I remember when I lived in China, you had to be very careful. If you heard that the Japanese had published another textbook, make sure you didn't put the television news on while you were having dinner, because they put the films of the rape in Nanjing on and the atrocities right in the middle of dinner time. And it didn't improve digestion. But the social media at the moment, they cut both ways. I think social media always cut both ways. On the one hand, there's big argument. Do social media support democracy? Are they something driving forward democracy, democratic change? But equally, they can be used to avoid democratic change, to put repressive measures out there. The danger of what they're doing with nationalism is that one day they lose control of it. And they have done. And they've been forced in the past to go further than they wanted to, because the oddly public opinion does count. Yeah.
I have two quite different questions. The first one is...
I give different answers.
Yeah. First one is, how did you speak when you spoke to the Chinese? You certainly didn't speak like you did to them. First question. And the second question is, when do you think that the Chinese economy in China will collapse?
Okay. How did I speak to the Chinese? I gave them about two-thirds of what you got to think.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So both the stroke of the ego as well as the be careful?
Yeah. I think my finishing line to the Chinese was that, or in the speech to the Chinese position in the world was, that China's long talked up a multipolar world. It's not there yet. We're still only in a non-unipolar world, but China must now start working to deal with the multipolar world it so wanted. It might find that the responsibilities are more uncomfortable than the opportunities. And that was my kind of warning line to them, which I think partly went down quite well with some people in the Communist Party, because that's the message. I mean, you get invited to speak there because people want to use your message for internal fights and internal conflicts. And there is no unity. If you think about the message I was being given during the conference, that we want to engage, we want to write new rules, we want to begin new institutions, and that seems to be reflected in what comes out of the plenary. And then suddenly they introduce this new aviation limit over the Diaoyu Islands. Like it's a provocation, but let's go to war, guys. And you find those contradictions happen because somebody inside, they have different views. And we saw that with Bo Xilai. But if you think about the Bo Xilai scandal, to me, I very much doubt his wife actually killed the British businessman. This was a massive setup because he had to be destroyed. If you look at how uncharismatic the Chinese leadership are, and they're pretty uncharismatic. And that's new in China, because Deng Xiaoping was incredibly charismatic, Mao was charismatic, with a very strange high-pitched voice. It was telling you in Beijing about when the People's Republic was announced. For a Beijing person, it should have been something like, and now instead of the Hunan accent and high pitched voice, everyone, and if you ever watch the film, there's a pause afterwards. Because all these, Beijingers, and Beijingers are like any capital city, like Berliners, they're like Londoners, they're pretty smart cookies, and pretty hard boiled, and got a pretty ironic sense of humour. And they're all thinking, and it takes a couple of seconds before the party bosses are running around saying, clap now, cheer, or die. Clap now, cheer, or die. Unfortunately, Chinese is the kind of language in which you can say that really quickly in four characters. And then you hear the applause coming out. But Bo Xilai is just too charismatic. This is a guy who's combining the free market with the old Maoist slogans. He's got them singing the East is red again. And he's got to be destroyed. And he's not just removed, destroyed in such a way that he can never ever get back, and they get the message. Yeah. He's just, to me, the destruction reminded me of the Lin Biao affair in 1970, where Lin Biao, nobody still knows what happens, but he ends up getting an aircraft, apparently he's launched a coup that failed. He gets in an aircraft and flies across Mongolia, and then they turn around to come back, and they crash, they run out of fuel, and the whole family's wiped out conveniently. It's similar. It's, you lose power struggles. Sometimes you have to be destroyed because you're too dangerous to be allowed to live. They don't need to kill him anymore, but they make sure he's just killed a British businessman. So. But sorry, it's the second question.
Second question is, when do you think that it's going to collapse? Because, well, I've read several things, more the environmental side, like from the ground, from being environmental policy.
Well, the environmental side I can talk to, because I'm going to see a specialist next week just to find out what Beijing put in my lungs. And that's 3.5 weeks ago.
But it has to do with global resources and everything else, and it looks like the collapse is, you know, in the foreseeable future. I just want to know what you think of that.
I think my personal view is that collapse is possible, and I never underestimate collapse, which is why, and then when I'm talking to students about, do you learn Mandarin Chinese? Well, possibly. Perhaps you might want to learn Russian, less likely, but there are lots of other languages you might want to learn. I think they've got a chance of doing it. And they've got a chance of doing it because they have a younger, very educated leadership who have recognised the problems. If you look at the plenary documents, the analysis side, it looks like a Western analysis. The environmental problem is right up there at the top. I mean, no choice, because you've got, they said that life expectancy in Beijing is now 5 years less than it was 10 years ago for lung diseases. And I'm talking to the one topic of conversation with people in Beijing, with the academics I was meeting, was talking about colleagues who died of lung diseases recently, in their 50s. And I'm still walking around, I'm still feeling it. I'm hoping they've not got me. But I think that because they've recognised the problems, and because it's a single-party state, and because the Chinese are deeply patriotic, they have a chance of pulling it off. There's a chance of getting horribly wrong as well. And it's a time issue. The immediate threat is the housing bubble and the fragile banking system. Now, they've got the advantage that in a single party state, to some extent, you can finance that away. It's not like Europe, where you have Jens Weidemann saying, no, you cannot print money, Mario Draghi. So they can just print money. They did in 2008, swamp the Chinese economy with money. The question, and I don't know the answer, but this is the question, can you do that in a semi-capitalist market on an unlimited basis? Or does the whole thing break down? If we did it in the West, it would break down. And, you know, we know our big crisis in America is, when does quantitative easing finish? Our big crisis in Britain is, when do we stop the quantitative easing? And does the economy rush back into crisis, like it did when the Americans started lifting measures in 1938? And they drove the economy back into recession. Can the Chinese pull back? These are going to be the issues. I don't say clearly the Chinese economy will collapse. I think on balance they might pull it off. But I agree with you, there are enormous risks on the environmental side. I think there's a systemic risk at the global level. As I said, we're in a transition period. We don't know what the global economy is going to look like. But I don't think it's going to look like anything we've seen before. Or anything we remember. We've lived through this period of Western domination, and we're now transitioning into something else. And the transition period is always dangerous, and we don't know what something else was going to be. And our political leaders are probably not thinking about it. The other reason I think China perhaps has a better chance than most is that Chinese leadership can think 5-10 years down the line and know they'll still be there. Yeah, our political leaders are thinking about next year, the year after next, how they get through the next election. George Kennan said democracy made foreign policy impossible. It might actually make systemic transition impossible as well. So I think it's a really interesting question. But I personally feel that at the moment the balance is more on the side of them pulling it off. Having said which, the property market will collapse tomorrow. What was Irving Fisher in 1929? I see no reason why the American economy should not continue to grow without limit. I believe the US stock market is undervalued. September 30th, 1929. Great economist and lousy forecaster. Yeah.
Actually, actually define China as Middle Kingdom, and in China we have another explain. It's like philosophy of Confucius. It's to be middle, to be reasonable, and not to be top. It's in Chinese and Zhongyu.
Mm-hmm.
I think you know this word.
Yes.
That means never to be a top. And if you see the history, and China never go out to encounter other countries. And this is the philosophy of Confucius.
It's really interesting because China did at one point. Well, first of all, you've got to look at different stages of Chinese history. There is a period in which China conquers China. So the Three Kingdoms period, the Warring Kingdoms period. I still remember learning Shuo Cao 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 Zhou Da. The Chinese equivalent to talk of the devil, the devil arrives. I mean, Cao Cao was this general who was not a nice man. So you went through that period, but then that period, one kingdom was allowed to dominate. One kingdom was allowed to take control of China, which is different to Europe. Now, there is a period when China's going around the world, but what's interesting about when China goes around the world is it sees it differently. Because China doesn't come from the... China's a civilizational state, it doesn't need to go and colonize. So when China does travel around the world in the Ming Dynasty, and Zheng He has these amazing treasures... It's wonderful, if you see pictures of the Zheng He's treasure ships, you know, Columbus's ships are like this. And Zheng He's treasure ships are like this. And you realize just how far behind we were in the Ming Dynasty. And then there's a decision to stop. But the first thing is, they travel around the world, and what do? They look for tribute to the emperor. It's still the tributary system. You don't need to dominate. Just the recognition that the emperor is the son of heaven. Tianxia, under heaven, is the emperor. The recognition of the emperor's throne, and that's all they do. So, I mean, if you go to China, then you go to the Ming tombs. Well, the wonderful thing is got the Ming tombs, all the statues when you go up to Ming tombs. And they're elephants, and they're rhinoceri, and they're giraffes, and you're thinking, what on earth are these doing in Beijing? They were never native here. But these are all the animals that Zheng He brought back from his trips to Africa. Now, the really interesting contrast is about 50 years after Zheng He has been in East Africa, the Portuguese turn up. What do the Portuguese do? They start killing people. They don't send things back. They start trading. Well, what do they send back? Slaves. They start enslaving local people. It's a violent encounter. But Zheng He's is not. I think that is true. And then Zheng He stops, and China decides.